Very good morning. I'm Sporting Leader Sargam, and I welcome you to today's edition of Mindfly Webinars, where we will talk about communication. We will talk about topics like reasons for silence, group interaction, amongst other things. Before we begin, I would like to tell you all that this session is being recorded live and will be available for you to view after this is over. We encourage your questions, and I request you to type in your questions in the chat box. We'll try and answer as many questions as possible at the end of the session. And I request all of you to remain on mute throughout. So we will now begin with the presentation by Captain Amit, who's been an aviator for the past 30 years. He's a safety and training expert and a fellow of the Royal Aeronautical Society. He's also the author of the blog Mindfly. Over to you, Captain Amit.
Thank you very much. And welcome aboard Mindfly. I hope everybody is safe and keeping fit. This is a short presentation, after which we will have a question answer session and discuss issues. So I'm just bringing about a topic for discussion. It's not that I am the expert or I know it all, but if we combine our resources, then maybe we can come up with a better thing. So today's session is about communication, or rather why we fail to communicate. So let me put the screen on. Take a minute. So we've seen in the past that CRM, crew resource management, or cockpit resource management, the importance of that and how it has added value to what we do, and at times hasn't performed. So when are the issues, when they become so big? So do we wait for issues when they become big, or do we address the root cause? So today's session is all about that. The topic is, if I speak, I'm condemned. If I stay silent, I'm damned. So this could be anybody, not just the co-pilot, even the captain or the crew. The issue is about speaking up, why we fail to speak up, and even though we are aware of the issues. So this is not a CRM class or anything, but just my point of view. I have done some research, pulled out some very important documents from different universities written by different professors. So I've combined them all to put across my point. So if we go to the initial slide, we'll see the effectiveness of CRM till date. So everybody knows that CRM is a training intervention for threat error management, but has it been proved beyond doubt? Do we have empirical evidence to state that CRM is effective, highly effective? This is what people have to say. Navigation consequences of silence can be grave. And considering that the crew members have been actively encouraged to speak up in the CRM for over three decades. So this is a 2000 study. These numbers give some reason of concern, because we continue to see CRM issues coming up. CRM is a contributory cause for about 87% of the aviation accidents. It's 2002. And it all started in late 70, 79, 80. A review identified 58 studies on CRM, which suggests that the data is encouraging. So people see a lot of change, but the change has not been recorded. CRM training was found to have produced a positive reaction, enhanced learning, and the desired behavior. So we could see that change. However, its impact on safety was unable to be determined. So that empirical evidence is not there. with which we can speak beyond doubt or with confidence that it is the most effective training technique. The one accident we will discuss, the Kegworth Boeing 737 in UK 1989. The Kegworth accident, we saw the Boeing 737 in UK. So they had an issue with left engine, the blade, vibration, smoke, fire, but the crew shut down the right engine. Co-pilot was a bit confused but did not speak up. And the captain, based on his previous experience, shut down the left engine. He made an announcement that we are shutting down the right engine. People could see the left engine fire and smoke, but nobody spoke up, not the passengers, neither the crew. So at about 4 miles, they realized and tried to start the engine, but it was too late. Could not, left engine gave away fire, and the aircraft basically crashed, and there were casualties. A lot of people survived to tell the tale, and that is why we learned from the accident. So why did the crew remain silent? There was a study done by these two Swiss professors. They wrote a paper and they examined the incident, accidents, and in particular, the Kegworths. So reason for silence, they examined the crew. The biggest was fear of damaging relationship, which was the highest in captains and first officer. Thereafter, purser was low on account of the service issue that he is normally looking after the cabin. So he's more concerned with what's happening with the passengers than looking around. So that is the reason why his rating or the percentage is low. Flight attendants are junior. So they're also bothered about a damaging relationship. We have lack of experience and feeling of futility, which means that nothing's going to happen. So that is futility. So there's nothing for the captain, first officer is there, flight purser. And we have the flight attendants. Fear of punishment, nothing for captain, he's in charge, first officer, the purser, and maximum for the flight attendants because they're too junior. We have the time efficiency. First officer, purser is maximum. He's got to manage too many things. And then the flight attendant. Status difference. So if we see the maximum is the fear of damaging relationship. That is why people don't speak up. It is for everybody. The flight purser is based on his task, because he's too engrossed in his tasks, so that is why it is low. So now we are here, back on track. We have the cabin on the left, where you have the purser, flight attendants, and on the right, we have the cockpit crew, captain and the first officer, and their role, status in the aircraft hierarchy. If you see the captain and the purser, they interact a lot. Captain and the first officer also interact, but the flight attendants do not. Maximum percentage, they interact with the purser. They do not interact with the captain directly or the first officer. So there is a fear in them because of their hierarchy, or they work under the purser, so they do not want to override his authority, his her authority. So those are certain issues, being too junior. So the whole idea is about CRM so that people can open up, and in case of issues like Kegworth, where you can see clearly there's a fire on the left engine, captain is announcing right engine. So you need to take charge and inform the captain immediately. So there has to be a direct line of communication. If you see communication styles, you would have noticed the Americans, they're very casual about it. It's not that they do not perform their job, but that is their culture. The British are totally different. You see, the person on the left is drowning. If he says help, just one word, nobody's bothered to turn. But if you say the same thing, express your urgency in a bit a longer way, more polite way, say, excuse me, sir, I'm terribly sorry to bother you, but I wonder if you would mind helping me. So they are more willing to help. So it is a cultural issue, the communication styles. So in India, if you see, it is different. The choice of words is different. And again, your rapport with the person, it matters. If you are close to the person and you're basically friends, so you can bother, you can afford to take more liberty and be direct rather than being over polite, like it's shown in the example. The co-pilot who's in a catch-22 situation is bothered about whether to speak or not to speak. So now we have a lot of, we have a checklist for incapacitation. So if we know that the captain is incapacitated, unconscious, so there is a procedure. It is easy to apply. But what if the captain is dangerously dysfunctional but conscious? So that thing has not been well defined or universally accepted. We have the two communication rule, three communication rule, that especially after the Bangalore air crash in India, it came up. The three communication rule, you say you're unstable, you remind him, then you finally take over, inform ATC. But that's good on paper. Is it practical and easy to do? Well, a lot of people will not take that chance. There are again reasons for that. It's not that they do not want to, but there are certain inhibitions. And we don't end up, want to end up in a cockpit in this scenario. So let's look at what's holding people back. So like the three called, another acronym was built, PACE, to prevent breakdown of CRM. First is probing for a better understanding. Then alerting captain of the anomalies. Challenging suitability of present strategy. And last is emergency warning. So, for example, the co-pilot, if he sees something wrong, first thing is to probe, which means hint that what you have in mind, are you willing to share what you have in mind? Then alert that, no, I see something wrong. So you build up like this. So will the co-pilot take over, provided he is empowered by the company? So the company culture and the company policies, they come into picture here. This is just an example of a company policy, which very clearly says that the pilot occupying first officer position is charged with the responsibility of informing the captain immediately and at any time should he believe the aircraft is being handled improperly or placed in jeopardy. The captain may choose to disregard this counsel, such as his command privilege. But no matter to what degree or how often such advice may be disregarded or ignored, the job of a co-pilot, the pilot occupying the first officer position, will nevertheless be held responsible for always offering advice. So he will never stop. So this is in the manual. This is clearly stated. Everybody knows about it. So the first officer is empowered. He will not think twice because he's supposed to do his job. And the captain also knows that he cannot shut the other person up because that is his responsibility. He's doing his job. Now there are different ways of communicating, like we saw the British or the American, or it could be Indian or South American. So everybody has their local nuances, their own particular words, what to say and what not to say. Certain words have different meanings in different contexts. So for example, the step one, if we see probing statement. So See, a British perfect English would say, Captain, I need to understand why we are flying like this. But a co-pilot, while he's saying this, would be thinking something else. Or if you see the West, if you go towards US, where the power distance index is very low, they might be very direct. So they could also say, Captain, aren't you painting yourself into a corner and aiming to shoot yourself in the foot? The second could be the alerting statement. Captain, it appears to me that you're on a course of action that is drastically reducing our safety margin and is contrary to both your briefing and the company's SOPs. So it is a very difficult way of speaking, but this is the ideal way. And what would be going in his mind, or the direct would be, Captain, it's my function and responsibility to protect your blind spots. I see you're about to walk off a cliff. So this is a direct method. And the first one is a very polite method of telling a person. There is something called losing face. So this is the Japan Airlines, which landed in Juhu Airport, whereas they were to land in Bombay Airport. So they mistook the runway. After the accident, they overran. There was an investigation wherein the co-pilot knew that they were approaching the wrong runway or the wrong airport. So why did he not speak up? Because culturally in Japan, it is a big issue. So the captain would have lost face had he told him that captain was doing something wrong. So he decided to keep quiet. And they ended up here. This is Guam, Korean. Again, high power distance index. The cockpit gradient is too steep. So they could not tell the captain directly. There were three people, captain, first officer, flight engineer. So the flight engineer indirectly would hint that today the city lights are too bright. He wanted to say that we are low. So he said the lights are too bright. Or the co-pilot said, the weather radar is functioning well today, which means look outside or look at the weather radar. There is weather approaching. So this is another way of speaking. This is called negative politeness. This is the Asiana in San Francisco. Again, many senior captain and junior co-pilot. This was again, there was issue with the automation as well, the level change trap, what we call in 777s. So there's a politeness theory by Brown and Levinson. It says that everybody has a face. A face means that you want to project your image in the society or amongst your friends and peers in a particular way, so that your face should not be affected at any stage or threatened. So the notion of face, it basically refers to social standing or esteem. The individual will claim that for her or himself and want others to respect. So everybody demands respect and they don't want that face to be threatened. So they provide the underlying principle of speech acts that participants will perform during communication, which may lose face or save face. These are called face-threatening acts. So if I want to ask something from you, I want to borrow something from you. So there are two ways. One is I will appreciate maybe your the dress you're wearing or the pen you're carrying or some other thing so that I come about in a very longish way, but I keep appreciating and you feel so elated that you are unable to deny. So the second option would be, I give you an option that I know you don't like to share things, but I need this desperately. So are you willing to share or borrow? Can I borrow this? So you are giving me an option to deny basically. So these are both sides of politeness, but in the second part, I'm giving an option for the person to deny. So if I am not very assertive and if I'm not very direct, so the person doesn't know. So when you are facing another person, so both the minds are working. So you are wondering that should I be direct to him? Does he like being direct? Or should I come about in a very, with some rosy words? The person receiving is also wondering that what does he want from me? So everybody is being threatened or feeling that threat. So that is one of the ways politeness, you have to be either positive politeness or negative depending on the situation. You're in an emergency situation, you have to be a bit direct. So using politeness may be a strategy for mitigating threats to face in verbal interaction. For instance, if a person A asks someone B to do something for him, this is a threat to B's negative face. So everybody has a social standing. You cannot just go and intrude their space. Now we've seen that CRM training has been going on for the last 40 years, four decades. Unfortunately, there's no means to record it. There's no empirical record. It is just that we say that things are improving, but that human factor stays at 87 or above 80% contributory factor. So we are being trained, but there is a gap there. The gap is between knowing and doing. So what is this? Awareness alone can't affect change because of something psychologists call the intention and implementation gap. So the intent is good. I am aware of the principles of CRM, but am I able to implement? So that is a gap. Sometimes it's also known as the knowing-doing gap. In repeated studies, scientists have found that little or no correlation between a person's intention to do something and they're actually doing something. So they measured it and presented it in the form of a table. So the knowing and doing gap, if you see the blue is don't do it and green is do it. So if we have no intention, then of course we will not do it. But there might be a possibility that a very small possibility that we might do something. But if we have an intention to do something, still the knowing and doing gap, so there's not much difference between doing and not doing it. So the idea is that if you learn something in training, you have to implement it immediately. Otherwise, there is no motivation of learning. So if you don't practice something, it becomes a theoretical thing. Then we end up with, even if we have an intention, which everybody has an intention of staying safe, but since it is only a theoretical thing and not practiced effectively, so the word is effectively and deliberately, so it ends up being almost the same as doing it and not doing it. Most of the times we are not doing it. So there's not much difference. So ultimately it's boils down to practice. Another thing is fear of rejection. Why we don't speak up. So first we saw the loss of face. We don't want to lose face. Second is we always keep thinking that if we speak up, what if the person rejects or denies me that opportunity to speak, or he does not accept my idea, or if the person says that it was not a good idea. So basically rejection. So the fear of rejection is very strong and it translates to the physical aspect also. So people fear rejection in any form of human interaction. Rejection piggybacks on physical pain pathways in the brain. In fact, the same pathways are activated when we are rejected as when we experience physical pain. So it translates the same as physical pain. And in a lot of cases, the same medication is given. So this is why rejection hurts so much. Because there's a wiring in the brain, which is similar. So speaking up poses such a problem for people because it involves something called social threat. Or there is also a social anxiety. We've all felt at one time or another those feelings of unease, anxiousness, or fear have taken over. So fear of facing the society is also there. We could be very comfortable in our closed, comfortable place with known surroundings, but when we face the society, unknown people, strangers, then that could affect us. That could cause anxiousness. So anxiety could affect us. So when we feel socially threatened, our brains divert resources away from high-level thought to heighten our senses in preparation to flee. So basically, brain is shutting down certain aspects to concentrate on the other aspects of anxiousness. So we've seen it in the previous presentations, previous webinars, that when we focus too much attention on something, then the brain basically, when it becomes overloaded, starts shutting down. Even your sensory systems, your hearing can be shut down. So that's why in number of accidents we've seen that even if the GPWS is blaring, we have so many warnings coming up, but the pilots do not hear anything because their attention is so focused on one job that the brain basically shuts down other sensory objects and the inputs. Being accepted in a tribe, so humans are social animals. So we want to stay in a society. Being accepted is good. Having a face, we have an image to protect. So all these things affect, we are conformists basically. So in order to stay in a tribe, we like to conform to the way things are happening in the tribe. So we do not want to stand out. Of course, there are people who want to stand out just to, because they have another set of image, another face to protect. But overall, maximum people want to stay in the tribe, and staying in the tribe having been the core behavior for millions of years. So we want to be conformists and do whatever people or in general want to do. Habit formation. So we have seen from the beginning why people don't speak up, because of rejection, you want to keep your social image, and the knowing and doing gap. So what prevents, what will facilitate is basically habit formation. So how do we form habits? So there's a very good book written, The Power of Habit, by Charles Duhigg. So he basically identifies a pattern or a cycle. So the step one is identify the routine. So to identify the routine, we basically have to find the cue first. So what is the cue and what is the routine and what is the reward we are looking for? So if we find this cycle, then we basically automatically form a habit. It is given in a few examples that if we like to eat, like we all like to eat sweets. So every time after every meal break, we like to get up, go grab some sweets. But this process will cause weight gain. So how do we break the habit or change the habit? So the next time there's a cue that you feel like eating a sweet, you have to break the chain. You have to form another routine. So we have to start from the end. What is the reward we get? So when we eat the sweet, we get a reward, a sense of satisfaction. So then you have to find a routine. What else gives you that satisfaction besides sweets? So meeting a friend basically recharges you. So does that give you that similar satisfaction? If you find that routine, so you have to incorporate that part. So your cue is that you feel like eating something sweet. So you go walk up to a friend, have a chat, go for a walk. So you get your brain gets the same sense of reward. So that is breaking the chain and forming a new routine. A very interesting case is about Alcohol Anonymous. So it is a very big thing now, even in the States, it is a very big thing. People feel that sitting in a circle and expressing their fears and whatever they have experienced, that cures them. But that is not the case. The fact is that after you attend Alcohol Anonymous for a week or 2 weeks, you go back, you again hit the same habit because you haven't changed your routine. So the trick is there, you have to find out what is the reward you're looking for. So somebody is trying to escape from his life. So that is why they go and consume alcohol. So what is the reward? So is there something else which gives you the same reward? So if you find that reward, then you can have a new routine. So Alcohol Anonymous basically works on that. They keep on finding what works for you. And then they put you on a new routine. So once you're on the new routine, then you basically forget the old one. Or it is very difficult to come back. Step two is experiment with rewards. Rewards are powerful because they satisfy cravings. But we are often not conscious of the cravings that drive our behaviors. So that is why we need to find out what drives you, the reward. Third is isolate the cue. And the fourth is have a plan. So there's nothing called addiction. It is just you have to find a way, or you have to find a person who can help you find a way. So when we talk about CRM and communication and behavior, so there are, you have to experiment and find different ways because everyone is a different individual. So in the cockpit, there are two individuals who come from maybe different parts of the society, different cultural background, but you are in an organization. So the organization culture, if it is strong, that binds you. So that should not be able, the other cultures should not be able to override the organization culture when you are in the flight deck or your workplace. So the solution is, as I spoke, organizations that have people locate this sense of threat on speaking up. So basically, if you have a common language, like standard callouts, so that helps you communicate faster, make decisions faster, and that is a basic bond. So when you fly with people who are non-native English speakers or from different part of the globe who cannot communicate in English, they can only speak in SOP language. So that is a basic English level proficiency level 4 operational, that you can pass on your message to the other person. You may not be able to strike a conversation, but there's something which is bonding you. So that is the operational level which is required, the level 4. Organization policies need to be framed, like we saw the empowerment of the co-pilot. So if it is clearly stated in bold and everybody knows about it, that this is the job of a co-pilot, he will not stop giving you advice come what may. So that basically empowers the co-pilot and he is then able to speak up. He's not shy, or he doesn't fear rejection. He doesn't fear losing his face. So this is the big statement, how you frame your policies and how strong is your organization culture. Lastly, Neuro Leadership Institute, NLI research around behavior change has shown that two other components must assist priorities, habits and systems. Like we saw the habits, Charles Duhigg, 4-step. Habits are automatic, non-conscious behaviors we perform on a regular basis, like brushing our teeth, stopping for a coffee and so on. So if we perform or inculcate good habits, so then it will come as an automatic reaction. So if you are tuned, if you make it a habit to speak up, so firstly, the other person also knows that this person will speak up because that is the culture and the SOP. So once it becomes a habit, so you don't have to think about what the other person might think, rejection, face. So it just comes out automatically. And systems are the physical or the mental cues, the scaffolding that reinforce our habits. So to reinforce a habit, we must have the policies, the framework, and the systems which support speaking up. So if I want to talk about CRM again, CRM nowadays has become, I would say, too complex. There are too many jargons in it. So when you come for a CRM course, which is like a separate course, you keep wondering that it is a 3-day course or a 2-day course. And it's a long course for that. And there are too many jargons, chapters, subsets. So how do we deal with that? So basically, we need to know the essence. And the basic essence should not be lost in the jargons which basically take you off the journey. So there is always a spirit of the rule and the rule itself. The rule will be in black and white, but the spirit of the rule is, why was the rule formed, under what circumstances and environment was the rule formed? So that basically holds you. That is the philosophy. So if you don't know the policy, you must know the philosophy, so that when you act, you should stay within what was the vision, why it was established. So basically, when it started CRM, we saw that there was a breakdown in communication. The other crew, supporting crew, was not assertive enough. So it is about putting your message across in the right way. So that is the essence of CRM. And from when it started in late 1980s, this is the fifth generation of CRM. There have been many changes. So as a subject, it has increased and become more complicated, but there should be an essence. People should know what it stands for, so that at the end of the day, when you are under stress, when you are threatened, the right words come out and that make that impact. So at the end of the day, two people or group must be able to talk to each other, listen in turn. So the essence of communication. So CRM may be dealing with other issues of behavior, personality, but at the end of it, are you able to communicate and put your message across? So that ensures safety. In conclusion, I can say that there is a need to collect empirical data to find out the effectiveness of CRM. So if you want the fifth generation to progress, we should know what has been going right, what has not gone right. So unless we have data on it, precise data, we cannot basically be sure of what's happening. And that 87% will stay around 87%. So even if the technology is improving, newer aircraft are coming, new generation aircraft. So are things becoming better in terms of safety, or they're becoming more complex? In the last webinar, we spoke about the design-induced accidents. So the majority, or 53-54% of the survey population, thought that new generation aircraft are becoming more complex because they're not intuitive. The basic design philosophy is, when you see an instrument, you should be able to read it directly. It should be intuitive. For example, if you want to push the nose down, you push the stick down, it goes down. Pull it up, it goes up. But for a roll, it becomes opposite, counterintuitive. And in case of emergency, for example, if you have a stall, then if the aircraft is going down, you have to push the nose down. So that is again counterintuitive. So when we go back to habit formation, the medical research says that it takes 66 days for a habit to form. So they have basically derived it from the medical facts. So if you lose a limb, and if it is rejoined, or if you have another operation on the limb, so basically after a period of rest, the brain forgets that there is a limb which exists. So now you have to reactivate that limb. So in 22 days, the brain basically establishes that, yes, there is another part of the body which exists. So the neural network joins. In 33 days, you're able to basically use that body, the part of the body, but you have to make a conscious effort. And in 66 days, without thinking, you're able to move like we all do normally. So a stall, especially, which is a counterintuitive, where the brain has to think what to do, because it is against what we have normally done so far. So it takes 66 days of practice for the brain to intuitively push the nose down. So that is a habit you have to form. So any habit you have to form, you have to continue to practice. Otherwise, there's a gap always. And it is not linked. When you want to use it, you won't be able to use it. Human factor, we've seen that 87%. That is because we just stopped the investigation at human factor. So it was a pilot error, human factor, we stop it there. We don't go deep inside or go to the exact root cause, root causes, which we now call number of causes, of why did the person do the mistake, the root cause. So we go to the symptom or slightly beyond. Cognition, we call it self-satisficing, not satisfying, but satisficing. Satisficing means the brain keeps searching. We search for options. So we search multiple options, but the first answer we get, we grab hold of that option and continue with that. So we don't dig further. So that is the same case with the investigations in human factor. So the moment we find that it is a human factor issue, we stop the investigation and we say human factor issue. That's it. We don't go inside that what caused the human factor. Was it a society issue, a personal problem, understanding, training, technical? So we don't go much beyond that. So that is why we don't have much data on that. Failure to speak up is primarily, we saw the fear of damaging relationship, social anxiety, fear of rejection, the gaps. Solution lies in strong organization culture. So you have people coming in from different, maybe professional culture, personal culture, their organization. So the company culture has to be very strong so that the influences are negated. We have psychological and neurological issues. And the last is we need new methodologies which have a holistic approach towards behavioral development. Right now, we are looking at very micro level, one aspect or two aspects. But there are things like interpersonal neurobiology. So a person's behavior is what we are interested in. So on day one, a person might behave normally, but on day two, he might snap under the same circumstances. So what's changed? Something in his neurons, in his society. So this concept of interpersonal neurobiology basically takes into account the sciences and the other soft parts. So that is a holistic approach to looking at issues. So with this, I come to a conclusion, and we can have a small question answer session. We have lost some time, but let's try to do our best to make up. And thank you very much. I'll stop the screen share.
Right. Thank you, Captain Amit. We already have some questions and thoughts coming in. So Nikhil, who's exactly talking on the same lines that you just spoke, where he says that while airlines employ communication rules and intervention models, how many actually practice it in the sim? And in the Indian context, especially where the juniors are not really empowered to speak up. So there needs to be some sort of a training to and a continuous practice. So what would your thoughts be on that?
This is the organization culture which has to empower the people. So like I said, people coming from different cultures and personal backgrounds. So they should leave the baggage behind. And the organization culture should be strong enough. So organization culture is basically, this is the way we do things here and nothing else. So if you get that message loud and clear, so that is the way forward. So then the co-pilot need not look up to somebody or hesitate, because that is the organization culture and it is very frank and open. Again, there is a gap between awareness and implementation. So in training, we are doing the ideal things, but when you go online, then it becomes a bit gray. So that is where the role of the captain is, to break those barriers and ensure that what the company wants happens.
Right. And how do you think CRM training could be made more practical? We've had it for a really long time, but we've seen that the results haven't help much. So how do you think it could be made more practical rather than it being just a 3-day classroom training session?
CRM is basically a training intervention. So the bigger concept is threat error management. And CRM is a training intervention to enable threat error management effectively. So the essence is basically lost. People consider CRM as the ultimate thing, but CRM only leads to the bigger thing. CRM is only a training intervention. So we need to know the background of what we are doing and why we are doing. So unless we are convinced about that, so we won't be able to proceed. Again, we look at communication. So CRM has a number of concepts, but communication is basically which bonds everybody. So unless we have it from the ab initio stage. So I tried to do this project in India. I worked 1 year with a training school. So I tried to inculcate basically the safety concepts of CRM, of, for example, stabilized approaches, of upset recovery. So if you introduce it at the beginning, at the foundation level, then the person is aware of these things rather than he learns something for 200 hours, then joins an airline where the airline tells you, no, you have to unlearn everything and relearn these concepts. So the airline is wasting resources, time, money, effort. But if the trainee can be taught at the foundation level, that the conceptual understanding is there. Otherwise, you'll have a basic understanding because your training syllabus is so overloaded. So the whole world is basically dealing with the loss of conceptual understanding. And even EASA has made a safety case that people are learning the multiple choice answers. So when it happens, the situation, when you face a situation in the flight deck, then you're not able to comprehend what's happening exactly. Because if it is out of the book, then your conceptual understanding will help you understand. So same is with the CRM. You need to understand the concept of what exactly you're supposed to do, not get foxed by the different terminologies, which even the trainers get foxed with.
Yes, right. Okay, we have Akashdeep asking, how conclusive are these psychometric tests in ensuring better CRM?
Psychometric tests, you need a lead basically. So psychometric test cannot 100% guarantee, because your behavior can change, as I say, because of your, maybe your society or your personal background, something has happened at home. That is why your behavior at workplace changes. So your psychometric stability evaluation has to be done periodically. It is not that if you do it once before you join the organization, start training, then your mindset or your stability is the same. So your circumstances change. Like people are in we're dealing with COVID. So your circumstances might change. People's finances might change. So your basically reaction to a stressful situation might be different. But psychometric evaluation basically gives you an indication that this person has a propensity towards a particular aspect. So under stress, this person becomes speech recessive. So that is one of the things which is checked. They put you under stress and your communication stops or reduces. So whereas you're supposed to probe more if something is going wrong, but you basically stop talking. So these are the things which give an indication of what can happen. And again, over the period of time, you have to corroborate these things. So before your beginning of your training, if you do a aptitude test or psychometric test, then down the line, if something happens, you basically corroborate. Did we see this in the beginning or did we miss this out? So your tests also have to be updated periodically.
Right. And also, what do you think can be done to break the authority gradient in the cockpit? Because that, as we see, is one of the biggest problems existing today.
Firstly, as I said, the corporate culture. Corporate culture has to set the ball rolling. Then your personal, the way you handle it. So, for example, in the West, particularly, they take the first name. So when you take the first name of the other person, you're basically saying that I know you. So if you want to be impersonal, so you take, you call him captain or you call him by the surname, Mr. So-and-so. But first name is basically giving an indication that I know you and I'm comfortable with you.
Right.
So that comes in open cultures like the US. So the moment they meet, or the researchers say that in the first few lines of the conversation, they exchange the names. I'm so-and-so, you're so-and-so. But if you compare it to the British system, so two people meeting, they won't reveal their names. till at the end of the conversation, before parting, they might say I'm exchange names. So it is a cultural issue. Similarly, when you move towards east, again, that gradient increases, power distance gradient, the gradient in the cockpit. So the organization has to step in that, no, you might have a personal culture, but when you are in the organization, then this will not basically hijack the agenda. So we will set the rules. This is the way we do things here.
Right.
So behavior also modified. Your behavior is controlled. So that is how you control your behavior.
All right. We have a question from Mahesh who says, how effective might CRM capsules be when done as an e-learning module as opposed to classroom training?
Well, training has to be basically face-to-face. Not just because of the issue that technology is improving, but that at the end of the day, we have to challenge ourselves. So if we learn something, for example, if we have a doubt or if we want to debate, so how do we improve? We learn a concept, we read a book, that's it, we close it.
Yeah.
So that assumes that whatever the author has written is correct. But I might disagree with that. So if I disagree, then I want to basically challenge that theory, concept, hypothesis. So if the person is not there, person of a higher learning. So a teacher is normally a person of higher learning. So if I cannot debate with him, so my personal understanding, my level remains the same. I do not grow. Same is with e-learning. E-learning, the basic concept has not been put across. So e-learning is based on intrinsic motivation. So for example, we play games. So people go to office where they earn money, but they come back, spend that money in playing games, which they are more interested. So when you go to office, you don't have that motivation, but you're still working there. But you come back, use the same money, and blow it up on games which you like. So what is engaging in the games? So that people have analyzed. The e-learning has to replicate gaming. So it is called gamification of learning. So you that game or learning, e-learning has to give you the same satisfaction as a game. So you have different levels, a leaderboard, you have people playing, you have to compete with people. So engagement. So motivation and engagement is not there in e-learning in the present form. Of course, a few companies are using it, like Walmart is using it. And their drivers who drive the forklifts, they have a small game to play. That game is basically based on your content, what you want to teach them in the form of a game. So you don't have to tell them to play a game. They automatically pick up the game, play it. In the process, they're learning. So consciously they're not learning, but still they're learning. So e-learning is a good concept, but it has not been implemented properly. So that is what, so if you have internet, doesn't mean that you have e-learning. So that is, you're basically digitizing learning in the present form as I see. So instead of books or instead of paper, we have the screens, but there is no connect. That is a big drawback in the current system.
Right. So Puneet says that even though we are one of the fastest growing aviation countries, there is a lack of communication between the regulatory authority and pilots or the license holders. So how do we bridge that gap?
To bridge the gap, everybody has to be on the same page.
Right.
Seen outside, when you go for a training program, you have the regulators with you in the training program. Because when you have to implement certain rules, regulations, then you need to know the background, understanding the pros and cons. So the regulator also needs to be on board. So a concept of collective decision making. So it is not that the regulator is at a higher ground or has a better understanding. So you make decisions collectively, which work for the industry, work for the regulator. So the regulator is basically concerned about safety. So how do you ensure safety? So that is the basic minimum that the regulator wants. But the operator is concerned about safety, efficiency, economy. So all the stakeholders have to sit down together and come up with the rules. It is not that one person knows it all. So that is the idea of having discussions and debates, conferences. So the regulator, that part of regulator's responsibility is to organize these debates and conferences so that ideas can be exchanged. So no one person can have the perfect idea, but together they can agree that this is a common ground and we agree to go on this path and we will review it periodically. So it is not a top-down thing. It is doing it together. So that is the way forward.
Right. We don't seem to have any more questions now. So any more comments from you, Captain Amit, or do we want to take some comments from anyone else?
Basically, the idea of the webinar series is to initiate discussion. It is not that I want to put across my point of view, but every time we'll have a new topic and there will be something unique in the topic. So like today we discussed in a way CRM, but not exactly what we do every day. So we try to analyze why things happen. So it is not the usual way of analyzing. It is somewhat in-depth inside the personality. So the cognitive part, the psychological part, so that plays a very important role, even in accidents. So maybe in the next webinar, next Thursday, same time, we can have a look at evacuations, something similar, why people or the passengers do not panic. We've seen so many videos of passengers very coolly taking off their luggage. So when does fear set in? So if you have any suggestions, you can email it to me. We can pick out a topic, do some research. But the basic idea is to have discussions and come up with new topics and new insights. Because that is how we grow. And that is the power of human brain, the cognitive part, that we are creative and we can build systems. Even artificial intelligence basically cannot think abstract. So we are able to think abstract and hear in murmurs. Basically, we have that sixth sense, the gut feeling. So there is also a science to that. So these can be very interesting discussions. You can choose a different format wherein people can contribute or speak their mind out. So your suggestions are most welcome, and we can continue with this. And discussion is the only way out. That is what my feeling is.
Over to you. All right. So to sum up, I would like to say that we know that communication is the biggest obstacle when it comes to extreme situations. And to overcome this, we need to focus on communication training at the foundation level. That is to say, at probably the aviation school level, where it is incorporated in the curriculum and through clearly defined roles and evaluation, and there are clear performance standards. Also, possessing good communication skills should be a mandatory part of the hiring process in an airline. So I thank you all for joining the webinar today.
Anybody want to say something? I think we saw one captain.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. Captain Prem, you want to say something? This is a topic very dear to your, very close to your heart.
Yes. Do we see CRM as an issue? Does it have, is it cutting across countries the same, or the country's culture also plays a very important role?
Companies, country's culture, like we saw in that politeness. So that is a theory by Brown and Levinson in 1980s. So they analyzed Indian culture and from where you come from. So the culture in the South, they analyzed the South American culture and a third towards the East. So as per them, culture is very important. Like we saw how people communicate in US or UK. So there are certain peculiarities. So culture is basically the foundation on which it is formed. That is what I feel. So you can give me your insights because you have a lot of experience in this field. Your any unique experiences?